Welcome to British Biomedicine Institute. Today, Dr. Pramod Khatre is going to represent a simple topic named as History of Clinical Research. And I hope you will enjoy our new skill degree in CTPRA. So please let me start. So clinical study is basically a partnership between subjects, sponsor, investigator, government and institutional ethics committee, and training can lead to higher quality, more efficiently run trials at a hospital. So here we want to protect the identity and safety of a patients who are participating in a clinical trial. So the main objectives are, we will discuss key research principles and the regulations, discuss unethical research studies and their impact on the development of research regulations, and also describe the roles and responsibilities of FDA and ICH. So what is the difference between the research and clinical practice? So basically, an activity, it qualified as research if it is designed to produce a generalizable knowledge. Second point, to collect clinical data in a systematic way, like with the help of protocol, and with an intention to publish the results which are available with the PI in a journal of repute. So basically, there are two translational blocks, where as there will be basic biomedical research in the block one, and after that it will move to clinical science and knowledge. And for block two, there will be a goal to improve the patient health, and basically there will be a translation of basic science to the human studies under block one, and under block two there will be translation of new knowledge to the clinical practice for the doctors who are treating a patient. So historical development of international guidance on clinical research are, the first, there were, this is the first history which was held between 6.605 to 562 BC, and it was carried out by King Nebuchadnezzar II, and he followed a diet of pulse and water, and Daniel recommended that the healthy patients who were on the pulses, and while the companion, they became ill who were on the water, and the king has to change his mind on the idea behind the diet for the pulses and for the water. So clinical research in the past were related to the auto experimentations. There were direct screening of the patients and multi-phase clinical trials. So James Lind is regarded as the father of clinical research or clinical trials, and he was the first person to introduce the control group into his experiment. He documented that the citrus fruit in the diet can prevent scurvy in the trial, and for this he recruited 1747 patients, and he concluded that the patients who were taking citrus fruit were fit for their duty. So under the history of clinical trials, a maritime experiment was carried out where the balance allocation was made like for 12 subjects, and there were various treatment groups, like quart of apple juice, a group will receive juice, apple juice, half will receive half pint sea water, nutmeg and garlic, where the dose was uncertain, and vinegar 2 teaspoon, elixir of vitriol 25 quarters, and orange and lemon. So these were the trials or studies which were carried out on the patients, and it was concluded that the patients who have received orange and lemon, they had a complete recovery, whereas the patients who receive apple cider, they have partial recovery, and those who have received vinegar, elixir, nutmeg or garlic, there was no effect, and the subject who has received the sea water, their health get deteriorated. So this was carried out by the James Lind, and it has been published in the Treatise on Scurvy 1753. That's why he is regarded as the father of clinical trials. So medicines at the beginning of the century, medicines were advertised and sold in medicine show from town to town in USA. There were natural products from the plants, animals or minerals chosen from on the basis of empirical formula. There were no control over the safety and efficacy, and there was no requirement for pre-marketing approval. A few drug proved to be effective, like your morphine, digitalis, quinine, which were later on reclassified as a NSAIDs medicines. So in the modern clinical trials, basically the placebo was first reintroduced in 1863, and whereas randomization was introduced in 1923. The first trial using proper randomized treatment and control group were carried out in 1948 by the Medical Research Council, and it involved the use of streptomycin to treat the pulmonary tuberculosis. So now comes the history perspective. In 1937, there was Alexander sulfonamide tragedy. 1938, there was formation of USFDA. 1947, Nuremberg Code came in existence. 1960 to 1962, there was a tragedy, thalidomide. In 1962, there was formation of US Kaufer-Harrison drug amendment or monitoring of INDs by the FDA. In 1964, US FDA, WMA, World Medical Association, or Declaration of Helsinki was framed. In 1964, WMA was formed. In 1976, US FDA monitor regulations were framed. In 1981, US FDA informed consent regulation came into existence. And in 1982, US FDA Institutional Review Board or Institutional Ethics Committee regulations, they came into existence. So basically, in the past history, there were various blunders, and the research was carried out in an unethical manner. So the sulfonamide tragedy, it led to formation of FDC, Food Drug Cosmetic Act. And for Nazi physician trial, again it is a blunder in the clinical history, and it led to formation of Nazi Nuremberg Code. Thalidomide tragedy, which was in the pregnant ladies, it led to formation of an amendment named as Kaufer-Harrison Amendment. And syphilis study, it led to formation of National Research Act. So now comes the creation of FDA. In 1906, upon Sinclair published the novel The Jungle, which described the unsanitary conditions used in the processing of meat in Chicago. And there were a public protest which reached the US Congress. And then the Pure Food Drug Act was created by the FDA in 1906. And they stated that the correct labeling is mandatory for every new drug. And at that time, the testing for safety was not required. So this is a diagram which shows the US FDA Cosmetic Act in 1938. And during the stripped elixir consumption, more than 100 people died in the USA in the year 1937, because there was mislabeling. And stripped elixir vial, it consists of sulfonamide and diethyl glycol. Due to mislabeling, 100 of people, they have died. So there was a catalyst event, or we can say sulfonamide tragedy. Basically, a new sulfur drug, elixir sulfonamide, was added as an excipient, and with the solvent, diethyl glycol, or it is used as antifreeze, and which leads to a kidney damage, and more than 100, or we can say 107 people, they died, mostly were the children. So in 1938, FDC Act, they passed a Congress, because of sulfonamide tragedy, and for that it mandated that there is a requirement of pre-marketing of the new drugs for the safety point. And it also strengthened the power of the FDA, which was formed, and it gave the FDA an authority to inspect the drugs manufacturing plant at any time. Under Kaufer-Harrison amendment, basically a thalidomide tragedy, it happened, and basically it was used to treat the early morning sickness in first trimester of pregnancies, and at the time of delivery, all the new baby born were deformed and they were limbless, and because the pregnant ladies, they were not informed about the ill effect of thalidomide, and there was no consent form taken from this pregnant lady, there were n number of limbless and deformed children who were born due to thalidomide tragedy. So in 1962, Kaufer-Harrison Amendment Act came into existence, and here there are two main rules for clinical research. First one is safety and second one is efficacy. So in 1962, Kaufer-Harrison Amendment, they framed two rules, like efficacy and safety must be demonstrated in the study before a drug is being available in the market. And this is the first US law requiring researchers to inform subjects of the experiment drug nature and also obtain the consent from the patients who are participating in a clinical trials. So in 1966, there was basically a rewrite, and here the consent required except in the case of emergency or experimental therapeutic treatments with children or similar situations. And there has to be a documentation of consent in writing, which will be written by the PI in the presence of CRC and patient in the source note form. And informed consent, they may also, we have to inform the subjects that during the treatment, the patient can also get placebo or best available therapy. So, in 1938, there was formation of US FDA, and I told you various patients died in this strict Alexander strategy, Alexander treatment, and Congress generated that US FDC Act requires scientific proof for safety of any medicine which has been marketed. Now comes syphilis study. So the study of natural cause of untreated syphilis, basically it was originally scheduled to end after assessing what health effect can occur. And in the beginning, there were no intent to deny anyone treatment on the long-term basis. And 400 African American men were matched against 200 unaffected subjects, because they were used in the control and they were not informed about the research objectives and what will be their benefit and what will be the risk. They were not informed. So in 1943, penicillin was accepted for the treatment of syphilis, and in 1951, penicillin was widely available but was withheld for the subjects, and subjects were never given a choice to choose about the penicillin which is easily available. In 1972, the study was exposed and it was a public outcry because it was a major blunder. And in 1973, the study was stopped. It was terminated. And in 1997, President Clinton apologized for the subjects and their family who got affected with the syphilis study. After this, there was a formation of National Research Act in 1974, and because it is the direct result of syphilis study, this was formed, act was formed, and it required the regulations for the protection of human subjects. And here the Institutional Ethics Committee, it play an important role because it will safeguard the protection of human subjects who are participating in clinical trials, and informed consent is mandatory before participating in any of the clinical trial. and it has created the National Commission for Protection of Human Subjects of Biomedical and Behavioral Research. So in this diagram, you can see that low pressure experiment is killing a prisoner, and a camp prisoner was induced hypothermia. So basically these trials are illegal or unethical, and patients were not informed well about the process and no informed consent was taken from them. So now comes the Nazi experiment. It was conducted basically without the informed consent of the participants, and it caused unnecessary pain, suffering and death. And there was absence of benefit to the participating subject, and it also lacked scientific rationality, which led to formation of Nuremberg Code in 1947. And it was the atrocities of Nazi experiment which became publicly available. And the trial for war crime included 23 Nazi doctors, and they were held culprit by the court. So in 1947, there was a Nuremberg trial, and 23 doctors, they were fined and they were jailed by the court. Nuremberg Code, 1948. This code was established for the purpose of preventing the atrocities of Nazi's experiment from happening again. And informed consent was mandatory, and subjects can voluntarily participate in any of the clinical trials. An experiment must be supported by strong scientific rationales with strong primary secondary objective. Thalidomide tragedy. In 1950 to 1960, thousands of children were born with congenital malformation. Basically, they were limbless and deformed in Europe, Canada, and Latin America. Pregnant ladies, they consumed thalidomide before pregnancy, in the first trimester of pregnancy, and because it was a pre-marketed test in 300 individuals, they were not alerted about the side effect of that thalidomide. Consumer concern reached the Congress in the USA, generating Cowper-Harrison Amendment in 1962, requesting strict safety and efficacy control for the new drugs. So in the diagram, we can see a baby boy or girl, they are limbless and deformed due to use of the medicine named as thalidomide. So there was formation of Declaration of Helsinki, or WMA, World Medical Association, basically after the ICH, International Conference of Harmonization, and Declaration of Helsinki, which was held in Finland in 1964. It was the most well-known international regulation for biomedical research, and it established the principles and rationale for research in human subjects. So various meetings, they were conducted by Declaration of Helsinki or WMA. Ethical principles for medical research which involved human subjects was adopted by 18th World Medical Association General Assembly Helsinki in the Finland, June 1964, and various amended were carried out, like 29th WMA General Assembly was held in Tokyo in October 1975, 35th WMA Assembly was held in Italy, October 1983, 41th WMA General Assembly was held in Hong Kong, September 1989, 48th WMA Assembly was carried out in South Africa, 1996, and 52 WMA was carried out in Scotland in October 2000. So the Code of Federal Regulation of USA, FDC, was framed in 1977. Basically, various types of rules and regulations, they were made, particularly they are known as CFR, Code of Federal Regulation. And they also introduced the concept of GCP, good clinical practice and data integrity of the participating subjects. So in 1978, Belmont Report came into existence, and basically the National Commission appointed in 1974 by the Congress of the USA for the protection of the human subjects who were participating in the clinical research. And there were three main ethical principles for a clinical research, like autonomy, beneficence, and justice. So in accordance with the ethical guidelines on biomedical research, which was held in WHO Geneva in 1993, 15 guidelines consisting of comprehensive reviews of A point, informed consent for the subjects, B point, selection of research subjects, C point, confidentiality of the data, D point, compensatory for accidental injury, F point, procedure for ethical review committees, and last point, obligation for sponsor and the host country. So review was carried out by 150 representatives from different countries, like Ministry of Health, scientists, ethicists, philosophers, lawyers, etc. And it is basically recommended for the developing country in order to protect the safeguard the rights of the subjects who are participating in a clinical trial. So in 1996, there was basically a conference, ICH, International Conference on Harmonization, and basically it is a international guideline for GCP to provide good clinical practice, to provide unified standard for European Union, Japan, USA to facilitate mutual acceptance of clinical data. It was developed with the consideration of current standard of European Union, Japan, USA, Australia, Canada, and WHO. The GCP section of ICH covered the three main elements, like protection of trial subjects, B point, scientific support of the trial, and C point, data integrity. The impact of international regulation for clinical research is it can improve the quality of the clinical research both ethically and scientifically in the last 50 years. There has been decrease in the frequency of scientific misconduct. There are now formation of standardized rules and regulations of clinical trials which facilitate global process. And it also promote the development of thousands of new drugs for the treatment of human disease, increasing the expectancy of and the quality of the ill patients. So in the summary, until 1906, there were no rules and regulations for pharmaceutical products. Nazi experiment alerted the scientific community about the unethical medical research, and Nuremberg Code established the need for the informed consent in the human subjects who are participating in any clinical trial. There was a declaration of Helsinki which introduced the concept of protocol approval by the Institutional Ethics Committee or IRB. FDA developed the concept of GCP, good clinical practice. ICH provide international guidelines for global research development. And the mandatory act here it is, we must enroll the human subjects in clinical investigation. And our main objective or motto is to be, do not harm the participating subjects or patients. There is a responsibility of the persons who are involved, like responsibility of PI, responsibility of CRC, pharmacist, CRO, project manager. So everyone has their own roles and responsibility. And investigator responsibility for the study design and subject selection is that will a study be broadly applicable to a general population, and are there special circumstances to apply to the study populations, and we can use the unique characteristics like medical situations which can come in hospital at any time. So this is all about the presentation. I hope you have gained a lot of clinical information through this presentation. Please like, share, subscribe our YouTube channel named as British Biomedicine Institute. Good luck. Goodbye.